That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This week, the Government rejected amendments to the Gender Recognition Reform Bill that would have stopped those awaiting trial for a sexual offence from changing gender. The amendment from Michelle Thompson, supported by Russell Finlay, would have prevented the situation where a survivor of rape would have to refer to their rapist as she. This amendment was not directed at trans people. It would not limit trans rights. It was solely intended to stop male criminals from inflicting more trauma on their victims. Michelle Thompson said in this chamber on Tuesday that leaving this as a possibility risked handing power to abusers. She said that the government is choosing to put the rights of alleged criminals over the rights of victims. The government stopped that amendment by a single vote. The First Minister's own vote means that a man standing trial for rape can claim they're a woman and force a victim to call them she. Why did the First Minister vote for this?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, where amendments were rejected over the course of the last 2 days, it was because a majority in this Parliament, having listened carefully and respectfully to the arguments, decided that for a variety of reasons those amendments were not appropriate, and Parliament has gone through that process over the past 2 days, as is right and proper. Over the course of the last 2 days, we have heard set out in this chamber many of the different ways in which predatory men can abuse women. My argument is not, and it has never been and never will be, that these are not very real ways in which predatory men abuse women. My argument is that none of these ways are created by this bill, and nor would it be the case that any of these ways are addressed by denying rights to trans people. The fact of the matter is, a man who wants to abuse a woman, even a man who wants to masquerade as a woman in order to do so, does not need a gender recognition certificate to do that, and nor does having a gender recognition certificate give that man any more ability or rights to do that than is currently the case. What we must focus on are the men who abuse women, the predatory and abusive men who do that, and this government always will in a range of different ways. Where amendments were rejected over the course of the last 2 days, it was often the case that was because there were alternative amendments that were passed to strengthen safeguards in this bill, but amendments that were compliant, in the view of the government, with ECHR and competence issues in a way that some of those rejected were not. So, for example, in terms of sex offenders, amendments by Shona Robison and Gillian Martin
were agreed
by Parliament. So these have been serious issues, seriously considered by this Parliament, as is right and proper.
Douglas Ross.
Well, we supported those amendments, but they were weaker than the amendment from Michelle Thompson. Roddy Dunlop, the Dean of the Faculty of Advocates in Scotland, said of Gillian Martin's amendment, it will not prevent harm, it will reduce the risk of harm. And on ECHR, Roddy Dunlop also said on that vote, I can conceive of no sensible basis on which this amendment might be rejected. That's from the head of the Faculty of Advocates in Scotland. But the First Minister's point here seems to be that this won't happen, that there's no chance that a violent, predatory male will ever try to exploit loopholes to attack or further traumatise women. But what if that does happen? Why would any of us leave the possibility that that could happen? One offence like that is one too many. Stopping an accused sex offender from changing gender is common sense. What is it that the First Minister and half of this Parliament thought was right to leave open the chance that that could happen?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, it is not my position, and I didn't say and have never said that predatory men will not seek to abuse women. My argument is that it is not this bill that creates the opportunities for them to do so. These opportunities, unfortunately, exist already, and it's those that we have to tackle. Nor would not passing this bill remove the opportunities for predatory men to seek to do that. And the reasons for the rejection of these particular amendments and the alternative amendments that were put forward have been set out to this Parliament over the course of the debate in the last 2 days, and a majority in the Parliament has taken a decision. That's how our parliamentary democracy operates. Now, let me set out again exactly what the position as a result of those amendments that were accepted is. And let me firstly remind the Chamber that we have in place already current provisions for the management of sex offenders that are robust. But we have already, indeed before stage three, given the commitment to expand the reporting requirements to include notification about an application for gender recognition. And the amendments by Shona Robison and by Gillian Martin, and of course agreed by a majority of this Parliament at stage three, further strengthen that. So these will mean that no further action can be taken on a GRC application where the police have applied for a sexual offences prevention order, sexual harm prevention order or sexual risk order that would prevent a GRC application. And it's also my final point, Presiding Officer, these are safeguards in this legislation that don't exist in the current gender recognition legislation. Because an important point that is often lost in this debate, because when you listen to this debate, it sometimes sounds as if this bill is, you know, either inventing trans people or creating for the first time a process by which somebody can legally change their gender. It is not. That process exists. And these safeguards that I have just set out don't exist in the current law, but they will exist in this new legislation.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister speaks about majority votes, but we know on Michelle Thompson's amendment, it came down to just one vote. And at First Minister's questions, I'm asking the First Minister about her one vote, because that amendment simply asked to pause the period that people can apply to have their gender changed if they are on trial for such serious offences. What was the problem with just pausing that opportunity for someone when they are on trial for such a serious offence? And it seems to be the First Minister has not taken the people of Scotland with her on these issues. Polling shows that a majority of Scots are firmly against key parts of this bill. A majority oppose reducing the time applicants must have lived in their acquired gender from 2 years to 6 months. And a majority oppose removing the requirement for a doctor's diagnosis of gender dysphoria. That includes a majority of Conservative voters, but crucially, it also includes a majority of Liberal Democrat voters, Labour voters and SNP voters. Lowering the age threshold for a gender recognition certificate was the most opposed aspect of this bill. Two-thirds were against it. And again, this included 63% of SNP voters, 67% of Labour voters and 75% of Liberal Democrats. Despite this, all three parties are backing the bill today. So why does the First Minister and her allies in this chamber believe they know better than the public?
First Minister.
We could all point to different polls on this issue. I could point to polls showing very strong support for what this bill is doing, including very strong support amongst women across this country. But fundamentally, and perhaps this is a point of agreement with Douglas Ross, all of us are elected to this Parliament and all of us have a very serious responsibility to make decisions and to be accountable for those decisions. At stage one, we will take the stage three vote on this bill later this afternoon. But at stage one, this bill was supported by members across every party in this chamber, including some members of Douglas Ross's party, and all of us will be accountable for the decisions we take on this bill, as we are accountable for all the decisions we take here. That is democracy, and I stand by the decisions I take, and I will be accountable, and I will set out the reasons for my decisions to people across Scotland on this and on every other issue. Removing the need for medical diagnosis for a trans person who wants to legally change their gender is actually one of the purposes of this legislation, because the need for that is one of the most intrusive, traumatic and dehumanising parts of the current system. And I believe I've been, you know, and as a woman, I know very much what it is like to live with the fear at times of potential violence from men. I'm a feminist. I will argue for women's rights. I will do everything I can to protect women's rights for as long as I live. But I also think it's an important part of my responsibility to make life a little bit easier for stigmatised minorities in our country, to make their lives a bit better and to remove some of the trauma that they live with on a day-to-day basis. And I think it is important to do that for the tiny minority of trans people in our society. And I will never apologise for trying to spread equality, not reduce it in our country. Finally, Presiding Officer.
Briefly, First Minister.
Finally, to come back to the starting question from Douglas Ross in that latest question. The reasons for not accepting Michelle Thompson and Russell Finlay's amendments yesterday were set out at length by Shona Robison, because we consider, having carefully considered them, that they would not have been compatible with the European Convention on Human Rights, which all of our legislation has to be, and therefore would have potentially compromised the bill. And therefore, we sought an alternative way of achieving the same objectives, and that is what I have set out already.
Douglas Ross.
Let's be very clear. We supported Gillian Martin's amendment, but it was weaker. It is weaker than Michelle Thompson's. And we had an opportunity in this Parliament, and the First Minister's vote could have made a difference to strengthen that element. But let's also be clear that the public are not against improvements to support trans people. Yeah. They are against this bill. The problem is not reform. The problem is the First Minister's reforms. While there may be a majority in this chamber later today to support this legislation, a majority of the public oppose the bill, including most SNP, Labour and Liberal Democrat voters. This bill reduces women's rights and potentially risks women's safety, but it doesn't need to be this way. So let me ask the First Minister and all the Labour, Liberal Democrat and SNP members who support it, shouldn't they take the time to get this right, instead of charging ahead with a bill that the people of Scotland do not support?
First Minister.
This is a bill that has been 6 years in the making. There have been two full consultations. Today it will be the culmination of a full and robust legislative process. In the last 2 days alone, we've had what, Presiding Officer, I think around 20 hours of debate on amendments. This is possibly the most scrutinised piece of legislation in the history of this Parliament. The issue here, Presiding Officer, and I say this entirely respectfully, is not the lack of scrutiny. It is that the majority in this Parliament, made up of members from all parties, including members in Douglas Ross's party, have respectfully disagreed with the arguments the Tories have put forward. And many of these arguments have been completely unrelated to the purpose and effect of this bill. That is the reality. Now, Douglas Ross says he's not opposed to reform, he's just opposed to this bill. Well, I've listened very carefully, not just in the last 2 days, but throughout this debate. I have not heard, I don't think, from Douglas Ross at any time any explanation or any sense of what form of bill he would have been prepared to support. Because I suspect Douglas Ross would have voted against this bill regardless of what amendments had been proposed to it. Now, that is his right, Presiding Officer. I've heard, I think, and I'll be corrected if I'm wrong about this, but I think I've heard Douglas Ross say that in the past, had he been in this Parliament when we had considered equal marriage, he would have voted against that, but has since changed his mind All of us have to consider these things carefully. I have thought very, very, very deeply about all of these issues for a long time, and I will be accountable for the decisions I make on this bill in this Parliament. I will always stand up for women's rights, but I am proud of the fact that I hope this afternoon Parliament will vote for a piece of legislation that will make the lives of trans people in this country that little bit better and easier. And I think that's actually something to be proud of.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, on this last day of business, can I start by wishing you and members across this chamber a very Merry Christmas, and in particular to the Parliament staff and all of our staff. We wish them all the best for the new year. Presiding Officer, over Christmas, thousands of NHS staff will be working when most of us will be spending time with our family and friends. They all deserve our thanks for the work they are doing to keep the NHS going over the winter and indeed all year round. But our health service heroes don't just deserve our thanks, they deserve better pay and conditions too. So will the First Minister commit to get back round the table with the Royal College of Nurses, the Royal College of Midwives and the GMB to listen to their concerns, act on them and avoid strikes next year?
First Minister.
I'll come directly to that point in a second, because it is one I take very seriously and the Government is and will continue to work very hard on. But can I also take the opportunity, Presiding Officer, to wish you, members across the Chamber and all of our staff a very happy Christmas. Can I take the opportunity, particularly as we break for Christmas this year, to thank the staff of this Parliament for the way in which they have gone above and beyond to support us in our responsibilities over the course of this week. We're deeply grateful to each and every one of you. And can I also take the opportunity to thank every single man and woman who works across our health and care services. We do that every year, but it is more important and more appropriate this year than it has ever been before. In direct answer to Anna Sarwar's question, the Health Secretary will be meeting with trade unions tomorrow. I think he was originally supposed to do that this afternoon, but parliamentary business has intervened. He will do that tomorrow, because just as has been the case up until now, we will do everything we can to avoid industrial action in our National Health Service. And we have, unlike England, Wales and Northern Ireland, we have so far avoided industrial action in our health service. And we'll do that because we want to obviously avoid the disruption that that will bring to patients across the country. But we also want to do that because we value those who work in our National Health Service. And I want to make sure they get the best possible pay rise that we can give them. We have maximised what we can do within this financial year. So compared to England, where there is a Conservative government, Wales, where there is a Labour government, and the Health Service Agenda for Change staff are being offered an average of 4.5%, in Scotland, the offer is 7.5% on average. That is a sign of how deeply we value our healthcare workers, and we will continue to have discussions, meaningful discussions, to do everything possible to reward them appropriately and to avoid any disruption in our health service.
Anna Sarwar.
I welcome that the Health Secretary will be meeting with the unions tomorrow, and I sincerely hope that we can find an agreement to get through this crisis. But these trade unions are not just striking about pay. They're warning about patient safety and conditions in our hospitals. More than a year ago, the Health Secretary announced a catch-up plan for our NHS, but things are getting worse for patients. In August 2021, when the catch-up plan was announced, 76% of people going to A&E were seen within 4 hours. That has now fallen to 62%. In July to September 2021, 83% of people were being seen within the 62-day standard for cancer treatment. That has now fallen to 74.7%. And when the catch-up plan was launched, 64% of patients were being seen within the legally binding 12-week treatment time guarantee. That has now fallen to 56%. Patients and staff are crying out for this government to get a grip. The catch-up plan has failed. Why is the government persisting with this failing plan, and when will they bring forward a new one?
First Minister.
Firstly, Presiding Officer, just to complete my answer on pay and to reiterate that this government will continue to make every effort to avoid industrial action. We are so far the only part of the UK that has avoided industrial action, and what I'm about to say is not intended as a criticism of the government in Wales, because I know how difficult it is, because they are working within the same constraints as we are, constraints imposed upon us by the UK government. But we have seen industrial action in Wales where Labour are in government, because there hasn't been the same negotiations that led to a higher pay offer than has been the case elsewhere in the UK. So I think the reason I say that is because people should take that as a very clear signal that we will do everything within our power and resources, and those resources this year are expended, but we will continue to do everything we can to avoid industrial action. And part of the offer to NHS workers includes offers around non-pay elements, and we will continue to explore how far we can go there as well. On the catch-up plan, of course, since the catch-up plan was published, we've had further waves of COVID. The pressures on our NHS have increased, and we have seen waiting times deteriorate as a result of that in many respects. That said, we are seeing progress in reducing the numbers who are waiting longest. So if we look at inpatient day case treatment, the longest waits have been reduced by almost a quarter. We're seeing progress in CAMHS waiting times. We covered that in some detail, I think, last week, Presiding Officer. These are the toughest of times for our health service as we go into this festive period, not just COVID, but flu, other respiratory illnesses, and of course, cold weather are all posing significant challenges. Our job is to continue to support the health service, and that is exactly what we will do.
Anna Sarwar.
The fact that the First Minister cannot escape from is that performance is getting worse, not better, since the catch-up plan. And failures have consequences. Patients are being asked to accept the unacceptable, and staff are being asked to do the impossible. And lives are being lost. On nearly every measure, things are worse than when the Health Secretary launched the catch-up plan. So let's look at this government's report card against their own performance standards. A&E waiting times failed. Delayed discharge, failed. CAMHS waiting times, failed. 12-week first outpatient appointment, failed. 8 weeks referral to treatment, failed. Cancer treatment times, failed. Detect cancer early, failed. GP waits, failed. Treatment time guarantee, failed. When will the First Minister wake up and realise that when it comes to the National Health Service, that this First Minister and this Health Secretary have failed?
First Minister.
Soundbites and full anger will not address the challenges in the health service. Patients and the public have a right to be angry and frustrated right now, but they also have a right to expect a government that is addressing these issues. I am not and haven't stood here and suggested that there are not significant and over recent months increasing challenges on the NHS and therefore on the performance measures that we have in the National Health Service. We are seeing that across England, Wales, Northern Ireland, health services across the world as the continuing impact of the pandemic and the other pressures on our NHS right now mounts. That's why we are increasing investment beyond any consequential funding next year for the NHS, £1 billion extra, asking those who earn the most in this country to pay a bit more in tax so that we can give more resources to our National Health Service. We're continuing to support record recruitment and numbers of staff in the National Health Service, and we are starting to see progress on the longest waits. What is happening here is that demand is going up. In many of these performance indicators, the NHS is treating more patients, but there are more patients coming forward for treatment. So nobody knows better than I do, the Health Secretary, the government, the challenges that we face here, which is why we remain focused on supporting our NHS through these challenges in the various ways that I've set out.
Question number three, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the First Minister what actions the Scottish Government will take forward as a result of COP15, the 15th conference of the parties to the United Nations Convention on Biological Diversity.
First Minister.
I welcome the outcome reached at COP, and of course that now must be followed up by all parties and at all levels with immediate and urgent plans for implementation. Our draft biodiversity strategy, which was published last week, sets out how the Scottish Government will do this. It establishes our long-term ambition and vision for a nature-positive future and sets out some of the immediate actions we will take to halt nature loss by 2030. I'm also proud that the Edinburgh process, which was led by the Scottish Government on behalf of the Convention on Biological Diversity, culminated at COP15 with over 300 subnational, local and regional governments joining our call for action. The resulting plan of action on subnational governments was adopted as part of the framework agreed in Montreal this week.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the First Minister for her answer. It's great to see Scotland playing an influential role on the world stage and supporting global progress to tackle the nature emergency. The Montreal Agreement could be a turning point in our fight to protect and restore our natural environment, to stop the declines and extinctions and protect the life support systems we all depend on. But any agreement is only worth the actions it results in. Scotland can help make the new global diversity framework a success by moving quickly to implement it. And that means big change to how our land and seas are managed and looked after for current and future generations. One of the key actions in the new framework is to protect 30% of our land and seas by 2030. But, however, recent reports have shown that many seas in Scotland are already protected, are in poor condition. Can the First Minister confirm that as part of delivering 30 by 30 in Scotland, the level of protection will be improved and nature recovery will be supported in these important places?
First Minister.
Look, that was a really important question, not just in the here and now, but for the future of our nature, indeed for the future of the planet. I think it was really good to see the headline target to protect at least 30% of the world's land and sea by 2030 in the new global framework. And of course, we are committed to implementing this in Scotland. Let me reiterate that we are committed to the expansion and improvement of areas managed for nature, and our 30 by 30 programme will promote ecological restoration and safeguard at a scale never seen before in Scotland. While almost 80% of features at protected areas are in favourable or recovering condition, and the long-term trend is one of improvement, I agree that we can and must do more. We're committed to working at a landscape scale and taking a collaborative approach to tackle the negative pressures on protected areas, and we're currently working with Nature Scot to take forward a co-design process with stakeholders to develop a framework through which our 30 by 30 commitment will be delivered.
Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Crucial to biodiversity is peatland restoration, and the Climate Change Committee recommends restoring 45,000 hectares per year by 2022. The Government's target was a mere 20,000 hectares. However, in 2020-21, this government restored 8,000 hectares, and it is reported that 80% of Scotland's peatlands are degraded. Now, the First Minister said earlier that the biodiversity strategy sets out actions the government will take. So what actions is the government taking right now to restore these peatlands, and in which year will she meet the restoration target?
First Minister.
We are, as a government, we're investing record amounts, and we're committed to record investments in peatland restoration. I'm happy to write to the member with more details of the timescales and our expectations around that. But I think we are recognised as really setting the pace in some of this, and of course peatland restoration is one of the key levers and the key tools we have at our disposal. The final thing I would say though, Presiding Officer, and I think it's something for all of us, but particularly those in government, to reflect on very seriously, across all of these areas, no government anywhere is yet doing enough or doing as much as we need to do. So therefore, it's really important that we continue to challenge ourselves all of the time, and we continue to be challenged. So I actually welcome this line of questioning and want to see the maximum possible challenge on this government to make sure that we are not just setting the targets, but making the investments and taking the actions to meet those targets, because there are few more important areas of work for any government anywhere on the planet right now.
Question number 4, Fergus Ewing.
Presiding Officer, I apologise for not being in my space from the outset at First Minister's questions. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government will set a clear ambition in its planned energy strategy for delivery of 4 to 6 gigawatts of solar power by 2030.
First Minister.
Energy generated from solar can, without a shadow of a doubt, make a very significant contribution both to the decarbonisation of our energy supply, but also to the just transition that we need to make to a net zero emissions society by 2045. Our draft energy strategy and just transition plan will be published, I can tell the Chamber, very early in January when we return from the recess, and it will contain a clear vision for the future development of solar energy. This will include the action the Scottish Government is taking to remove barriers to solar deployment, and through the consultation we will also seek views and evidence on whether and also at what level a deployment ambition should be set. It's vital that we ensure any deployment ambition is appropriate, stretching but also achievable, and I would encourage all stakeholders to engage with the draft vision and consultation process.
Fergus Ewan.
The answer, your answer, First Minister, will be received very warmly by those across all parties in this chamber that support developing Scotland's solar potential, so I'm very grateful for that. I wonder if I can just pursue one aspect, however, and that is that in the planning system and the national planning framework, precedence is given to those forms of renewable energy where there is a clear identified ambition and target. No target, little development, the opportunity may slip through our fingers like mercury. So in order to achieve the enormous potential that solar energy can contribute to our transition to a clean electricity system of generation, will the First Minister bear this point in mind so that precedence is given to solar power by having a very clear, practical, deliverable, achievable target?
First Minister.
I'm sure I know Fergus Ewing would have been listening very carefully to what I said. I think without going further before we've published the consultation, what I was very clearly indicating in talking about consulting on whether and at what level we set a deployment ambition, that I do recognise the importance for the reason Fergus Ewing set out, but for other reasons as well, not least activating a supply chain and benefiting the economy, there is an importance attached to targets. That's why we already have targets for offshore and onshore wind, for hydrogen, for example. So I hope Fergus Ewing will take that positively. And the final thing I would say, which he has already alluded to, and this is a reason for consulting on this, it's important, and go back to the previous question here, it's important not just that we set a target, but that we make sure that is both stretching and achievable. So the consultation is an important part of this process, which is why I would encourage all those with an interest to take part in it.
Question number 5, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reported warnings that the implementation of the deposit return scheme will be, and I quote, ruinous for consumers and businesses.
First Minister.
Well, I don't agree with that. The deposit return scheme will be a major part of our efforts to reduce litter, cut emissions and build a more circular economy. Good progress is being made by industry ahead of the scheme's introduction in August 2023, and that indeed is reflected in the most recent Gateway review, which noted that good progress has been made and that successful delivery of the scheme is now achievable. We're very aware of business concerns and some outstanding issues, and we take these seriously. That's why we've committed to a pragmatic approach to implementation and are taking action to help make the scheme more efficient and to reduce costs. Last week, for example, fees for drinks producers were substantially reduced by the scheme administrator, and we committed to lay regulations so that only the largest grocery retailers will be obliged initially to provide a take-back service for online and distance sales.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. The deposit return scheme has been scaled back, but we all want it to succeed. But understandably, businesses are worried about the potential for it to go wrong. That worry is fuelled by the confusion, secrecy and lack of information that surrounds the scheme. I know none of us wants that, and we must make sure the scheme is more transparent to increase confidence in it. The Scottish Government has the power to make the scheme administrator subject to freedom of information requests. Will the First Minister do that?
First Minister.
I'll give consideration to any request and any suggestion that is made in the Chamber, so I will take that away and give that consideration and discuss that with colleagues. I do believe, though, there is transparency around the work that has been done around the scheme. We had a review carried out just in October concluding that the programme has gained increased momentum, is in an improved position, and that go-live date in August is feasible. I think that's testament to the efforts being made by industry, by Circularity Scotland, working together to ensure that the scheme is implemented. Last week, the Minister wrote to the committee setting out the further steps that we are taking, listening to the concerns of industry to make the scheme more efficient and to reduce costs. So the day one payments are being reduced. Last week, we published new producer fees, or rather Circularity Scotland published new producer fees that are lower than previously indicated, and other changes are being made to try to take account of the concerns of industry. So I think that is positive, and of course we will continue that collaborative approach as we go through the months leading up to implementation.
Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you. Has the Scottish Government asked those conducting the gateway reviews into the deposit return scheme to interview representatives of organisations who are running successful deposit return systems, and especially those who have most recently set up their systems that are much cheaper for producers and have come online more quickly?
First Minister.
I'm certainly happy to check the detail to that question. I'm not sure exactly which individuals or organisations the member is alluding to, whether here in Scotland or in other countries that already have schemes in place. I would expect any gateway review to take broad-based evidence, but in terms of what particular organisations have been spoken to and what detail has been attracted from that, I will come back to the member with fuller detail in due course.
Question number six, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what progress the Government has made in ending the use of hotels as temporary accommodation for children and families.
First Minister.
Local authorities have used hotels to discharge their duties as part of the emergency response to COVID. The data on this, of course, is held by local authorities rather than by the Scottish Government. However, our homelessness in Scotland statistics showed that although there was an increase in the number of children in temporary accommodation in 2021-22, the social sector was the most common type of temporary accommodation used. 20 local authorities have reduced the number of households living in temporary accommodation when compared to 2021, and 10 of these have reduced the number of children in temporary accommodation. The Housing Minister has asked an expert group for an action plan to reduce the numbers of people in temporary accommodation and the length of time spent there, with a strong focus on households with children.
Paul Sweeney.
I thank the First Minister for that answer, but in response to a recent written question, her Cabinet Secretary acknowledged that hotels are unsuitable accommodation for people seeking asylum and condemned the Home Office's use of bed and breakfasts. However, I understand that lone children who may be seeking asylum and are in the care of Scottish local authorities and not the Home Office are also being placed in unregulated hotel accommodation amongst adult members of the wider homeless population and without cooking or laundry facilities. The Scottish Government condemning Home Office use of hotel accommodation means nothing if devolved care services are acting in the same manner. So can the First Minister advise what steps this working group are taking to urgently relocate these lone children to supported accommodation, and can she make a commitment that no further children who are alone will be placed at risk in these unregulated hotels?
First Minister.
I agree absolutely with the sentiment of that question. If Paul Sweeney has any more information he wants to pass to us about instances that he's talking about here, I would be very keen to look at that. None of us want to see launch any children where we can possibly avoid it in temporary hotel or bed and breakfast accommodation, but certainly not lone children in the kind of circumstances that have been narrated to the Chamber. So we'll look further into that specific point. More generally, none of us want to see hotel accommodation being used as temporary accommodation unless that is absolutely necessary. I know I have situations in my own constituency where this is an issue both for homeless people and for communities as well. But there have been demands on local authorities, particularly during COVID. It should be stressed, though, that most temporary accommodation is in the social sector. And as I said, many local authorities are now seeing a reduction in that. But there is much work to do here, which is why we are investing in more affordable housing, investing more in homelessness services, prioritising the Housing First model. So these are really important issues, and I know the Housing Secretary would be happy to engage further about some of the particulars behind the question.
Thank you. We'll now take general and constituency supplementaries, and I call Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Nearly 2 million UK households are behind on bill payments as Christmas approaches, according to a new survey from Which. As the Tory cost of living crisis runs out of control, can I ask the First Minister what support is the Scottish Government providing to people to help them stay afloat this winter? And what more could the Scottish Government be doing if it had the full powers over tax, welfare and energy pricing?
First Minister.
I mean, many people, as we go into this festive season, of course, are finding life more difficult than at any time that most of us can remember. And I think we have to be very aware of that. The cost of living crisis is hurting very many individuals, families, businesses right across the country. The Scottish Government is doing and will continue to do everything we can to help people deal with that. As it has been set out many times in the Chamber, we are investing around £3 billion in this year on initiatives and measures that will help people with the cost of living. We have taken new initiatives, such as the Scottish Child Payment, for example. We have spoken, I have personally convened summits with the energy companies and advice agencies to ensure that we are doing as much as possible. Although it is true to say that many of the root causes of what we are dealing with right now lie out with the powers of this government. Full control over the tax and the benefit system, of course, regulation of the energy sector. And if we had those powers, it is undoubtedly the case that we'd be able to do much more in a more coherent and joined up way to help people not just deal with the consequences of this, but to deal
briefly,
much better
First Minister.
With the root causes too.
Thank you. Liz Smith.
Thank you. May I ask again if the First Minister will finally grant a full independent inquiry for the former patients of Professor El Jamel. There are now 50 former patients who have come forward, each with their own very harrowing stories. And the First Minister will be aware that several other MSPs, including Michael Mara and Willie Rennie, now believe that this is the only way to get to the truth and deliver justice for these former patients.
First Minister.
We will continue to give consideration to that call, absolutely understand the views of those who have been affected and the ordeal that they have suffered. The Cabinet Secretary has met with the Health Board leadership. The review commissioned already by the Scottish Government included detailed reviews of care. But of course we understand the desire of patients to ensure that any process that can lead them to an assurance that they have all of the answers that they can possibly get. We understand that desire. And while we are not at this stage convinced that a public inquiry would lead any more to that, we will continue to give consideration to these issues.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to raise with the First Minister the case of a constituent who has contacted me after being told that waiting list for a Yag laser capsulotomy treatment can be as long as 70 weeks. This constituent is going blind, struggling to care for disabled children and having difficulty sleeping because he needs this procedure. I have already raised this matter with the Cabinet Secretary for Health, who blamed the pandemic for the waiting times. But contrary to his response, NHS Lothian have told me that these waiting times are not in effect down to the COVID, but instead down to lack of leisure available to perform the treatment. Could I therefore ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to ensure that NHS has the equipment it needs to tackle the waiting list and if it is acceptable that people should be told they are on a 16-month waiting list with failing eyesight for a treatment that typically takes only a few minutes.
First Minister.
Well, can I say two things, one particular and one more general. On the particular, I appreciate the Member says he's already written to the Cabinet Secretary. I will look at the detail of that case myself, particularly if the Health Board is saying that there is an issue with lack of equipment, and if there is action we can take there, we will certainly give consideration to that. The more general point is actually a point I made earlier. In response to Anna Sarwar, we are focusing on reducing, in these times of significant pressure, on reducing those who have been, the times of those who have been waiting longest for treatment. And that is where we are seeing progress. I appreciate that is no comfort to somebody who is still waiting, but we have seen a 24% reduction already in the longest waits for inpatient treatment. And that is why we will continue to focus on the longest waits, because we know the distress that that can cause. But in the particular case that has been raised, I will look at the circumstances, and if there is more information I can offer, I will write to the member.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Travellers throughout the UK are going to experience disruption over the festive period as a result of what the STC General Secretary, Ros Foyer, described as the combative approach to negotiations taken by the UK Government. Can I ask the FM what representations she has made to the UK Government to get round the table and engage constructively with trade unions to secure a railway that benefits users, staff and the wider public?
First Minister.
Well, I appreciate Bill Kidd raising this issue. I mean, as he has said, but it is important to underline this is not a Scottish dispute. The Scottish Government has maintained constructive discussions with trade unions, and we have settled pay negotiations here by embracing the concept of fair work. Despite that, passengers in Scotland are still facing severe disruption as a result of the ongoing UK-wide rail dispute between Network Rail, the UK Government and trade unions. Network Rail employees in Scotland face entering the new year still with no pay rise in the travelling public face further disruption. So while this is not a matter in which the Scottish Government has any direct locus, unfortunately, I yesterday joined with the STUC in calling for the Secretary of State to intervene immediately to avoid further disruption for users, staff and taxpayers, and to deliver a fair pay deal for those who work on our railways. And I hope that's something the entire Parliament can get behind.
And Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, MSPs have been sitting in this chamber after midnight for the past 2 days in a row. On Tuesday, as the Stage 3 gender recognition debate was underway, one woman was thrown out of the gallery and another law-abiding woman was threatened with arrest. Legislation rushed, criticism ignored and women silenced. Does the First Minister agree that events of this week have reflected badly on this bill's passage through Parliament?
First Minister.
I think some of the elements of our proceedings this week have reflected badly on the Conservative Party, Presiding Officer. Thank you. I recognise different and sincerely held views on this bill. But notwithstanding that, what we saw from the Conservative Party were deliberate attempts to filibuster, yep, to delay, yep, and to frustrate the decision-making, yes, process. Neither yesterday or the day before were we timetabled to go beyond midnight or anything like it. Yep. The reason it took so long was the filibustering, yep, and other actions of the Conservative Party. Beyond that, Presiding Officer, as you well know, I am not responsible for policing the public gallery. I support those who do that very difficult and important job, but that is not for me. What I do believe is that no matter our different views on this legislation or any matter, all of us should always treat this Parliament with respect and allow it to do its work properly. And perhaps the Conservative Party might want to reflect on that over the recess.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. Point of order, Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, members. May I seek your guidance, Presiding Officer, in relation to Rule 9.12 of Standing Orders, which sets out the provisions regarding financial resolutions for bills at all stages. Before any amendments were lodged to the bill, the Scottish Government's own cost, and that's the GRR bill, own cost estimates were £500,000 for the legislation, which, as members know, is the threshold for triggering the need for a financial resolution. And given the nature of several amendments which passed at stage three, I am concerned that these costs will now have increased, thereby requiring the need for a financial resolution. For example, Gillian Martin's amendment imposed additional requirements on Police Scotland when they apply for sexual offence prevention orders. There are currently no costs mentioned in the financial memorandum incurred on Police Scotland, but this will clearly add one. There are amendments adding in new offences of fraud, which will require our judicial authorities to receive more resources to deal with the additional offences they will have to interact with as a result of this bill's passage. Again, no costs are mentioned in the financial memorandum about costs to deal with new offences created under the bill, so this needs to be factored in. A new section was added in at stage two of the bill, allowing sheriffs to make an order applying to revoke a gender recognition certificate application upon request to the Register General. This would impose an additional caseload on sheriffs, which are not mentioned in the financial memorandum. Furthermore, the Scottish Government are required to produce further guidance as a result of amendments passed during this bill's proceedings, and the Register General must publish information on the website, neither of which are mentioned in the financial memorandum and will add further costs to the Scottish administration. So I seek your guidance, Presiding Officer. In commencing the following debate, I believe that we would be in breach of Standing Orders Rule 9.12.3 and 3A states, and I quote, no proceedings may be taken on the bill at any stage after stage one unless the Parliament has by resolution agreed to the expenditure. We would not deem, Presiding Officer, to preempt your ruling on this matter, but do you agree that proceedings should at least be suspended in order to examine the cost implications of these amendments and provide a ruling on any new requirement for a financial resolution? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I thank Ms Hamilton for her point of order. A financial resolution is, of course, required indeed if the likely expenditure arising from the bill would be above £500,000 in any one financial year. In the case of this bill at introduction, I determined that the likely expenditure arising from this bill would not exceed that figure. A series of amendments lodged at stages two and three potentially had cost effects for future financial years, but I can confirm that none of these amendments, either on their own or cumulatively, were considered to take the costs above the threshold in any one financial year.